Good morning, students. Welcome back to the course of software testing methodologies. This video is brought to you by Newton's Group of Institutions, Macherla. This is Arvind Egireddy from the Department of Computer Science and Engineering. So today, in this lecture, let us discuss about model for testing. So what is a model? A model is nothing but it is a design. So here in this picture, you can see the structure of the model. And now let us see its definition at each stage based on the aspects to get the outcome. So firstly, we know that software is going to perform based on the program model. So here the program model, which defines some of the models to get the outcome. And let us go each model one by one. First one is environment. So now let us first define the environment. So here in the environment, what we do is we gather the requirements or the components that are required and are used to develop the software. So in this environment, we will see whether all the components are valid or not for that particular environment. So here, the program's environment is the hardware and the software that is required to make it run. And for offline systems and online systems, the environment may include communication lines, other systems, terminals, and operators. So here, the environment, which also includes all the programs that interact with and are used to create the program under the test, such as operating system, linkage editor, loader, compiler, utility routines. And based on the hardware and firmware, which are stable, it is not smart to blame the environment of bugs. So here, basically, the environment, which depends on the environmental model. Now, coming to the second one, that is a program. So here, the program is the one in which the mainly we depend on the program model. So here the program depends on the program model. So most programs are too complicated to understand in detail. So the concept of program is to be simplified in order to test it. If simple model of the program does not explain the unexpected behavior, then we may have to modify that model to include more facts and details. And if that fails, then we have to modify the program itself. So here, coming to the next, that is nature and psychology. This nature and psychology, which depends on the nature of the product and the psychology of the customer. So for example, consider cost. Some customers can bear high cost. Some of the customers, they cannot bear high cost. So based on the customer's psychology, we have to develop the product. So this nature and psychology can lead to the bugs, or which can lead to the bug model. So if the bugs rises, then only we can satisfy the customer. So bugs are deceiving. Of course, they are harmful. Then what we have to do if the bugs come? What we have to do is we have to rectify those bugs. So if an unexpected test results, which may lead us to change our notation of what a bug and our model of bugs. So some optimistic notations that many programmers or the testers, they have about these bugs are usually unable to test effectively and unable to justify the direct tests most programs need. So here there are three types of modes. One is environmental model, program model, and a bug model. So now let us see the optimistic notations about bugs. So the first notation for bug is Benjin bug hypothesis. So here, these Benjin bug hypothesis, the meaning of Benjin is which are not dangerous. So the belief that these bugs are very nice, tame, and they are logical. And the second notation for bug is bug locality hypothesis. And the belief about these bugs is these bugs are discovered within a component that affects only that particular component's behavior. Such bugs we call them as bug locality hypothesis. And the third kind of bug is control bug dominance. So here, the belief that errors in the control structures like if, switch, etc. of the program, they are going to dominate the bugs. So here, control bugs are going to come through control operations like if, switch, do, while do, so on. Next, code or data separation bugs. So the belief that these bugs represent the separation of code and data. Lingua Salvator estimates. So here the belief is that the language syntax and semantics, example like structured coding, storing typing, etc. So these are the causes for the lingua salvator bugs. Then correction abide. So the mistakes being that are corrected, but still the bug remains uncorrected. Next kind of bugs is silver bullets. So here these silver bullets is that they are going to give the immunity for the bugs. So these are being due to the languages or the design methodologies what we are using, or the representation, or the environment where we are using this. So based on that, if the bugs come, what they do is they give immunity to the bugs. And the next one is sadism suffixes. So the common belief that a sadistic streak, low cunning, and intuitions are sufficient to eliminate most bugs. So those the bugs need methodology and techniques. So here, such a kind of bugs, what we have to do is we have to especially eliminate them by using independent testers. Next, the last notation is angelic testers. So here, the belief is that the testers are better at the test design than the programmers are at the code design. So now let us see the different tests what we are going to use. So here the tests are nothing but they are the formal procedures or the inputs that must be prepared, and the outcomes should be predicted, and these tests should be documented. Commands need to be executed and the results are to be observed. So all these errors are subjected to error. So here we do three kinds of testing on a typical software. They are unit and component testing. Here a unit is nothing but it is a small testable piece of software that can be compiled, assembled, linked, loaded, etc. So here a unit is usually the work of one programmer and consists of several hundreds or few lines of code. And unit testing is the testing what we do to show that the unit does not satisfy its functional specification, or that its implementation structure does not match the intended design of the structure. So here, a component which is an integrated or an aggregate of one or more units. So here, component testing is the testing what we do to show that the components are not going to satisfy the functional specification, or that its implementation structure which is not going to match the intended design structure. And the second kind of testing what we are going to use is integration testing. So here integration testing is the process by which these components are aggregated to create large components. Integrated testing is the testing done to show that even though the components were individually satisfactory, when they are combined, the components are incorrect and inconsistent. And the third type of testing is system testing. So a system is a big component. So once after integration testing, after integrating, now we have to test the entire system. So system testing is aimed at revealing the bugs that cannot be attributed to components. So it includes testing for performance, security, accountability, configuration, sensitivity, startup, and recovery. Now let us see the different roles of the model. So the art of testing, which consists of creating, selecting, exploring, and reversing the model. So here our ability to go through this particular process, which depends on the number of different models what we have at hand and their ability to express the program's behavior. Now let us see what is meant by playing pool and consulting oracles. So here testing is something which is like a pool game. So either you hit the ball to any pocket, or you can specify the pocket in advance. So is the testing. So this is a kiddie testing and a real testing. So in kiddie testing, the observed outcome will be considered as the expected outcome, whereas in real testing, the outcome is predicted and documented before the test is run. So here, the testers who cannot make that kind of predictions, they do not understand the program's functional objective. So here, what is a oracle? So this oracle is nothing but it is any program or a process or a body of data that specifies the expected outcome of set of tests as applied to an tested object. So here the example for oracle is input or output oracle. So here an oracle that specifies the expected outcome for the specific input. Now, what are the sources for this oracle? So let us see the sources of oracle. So if every test design had to analyze and predict the expected behavior for every test case, for every component, then the test design would be very expensive. So the handset part of the test design is predicted the expected outcomes. But here we often have oracles that will be reducing the work. So here the things that reduce this work is one is kiddie testing. So here the kiddie testing, we run the test and see what comes out. So if you have the outcome in front of you, and especially if we have the values of the internal variables, then it is much easier to validate the outcome by analysis and show it to be correct. So here that is to be predicted. So what outcome should be, and we have to validate our prediction. So here we will be having both the input and the output. So for what particular input, what output has to come, that we know. So if the same output comes, then we validate it to be true. If the outcomes differ, then we say that the test fails. Then regression test suite. So here today, software development and testings are dominated not by design of the new software, but by the rework and maintenance of the existing software. So in such instances, most of the tests what we need and will have been run on the previous versions. So most of those tests should have the same outcome for the new version also. So here our outcome predictions is therefore needed only for changing the parts of the components. And the third one is purchase suit and oracles. So here highly standardized softwares that differ only as the implementation, which often has a commercially available test suits and oracles. So here the common examples are the compilers for standard languages. Next, existing programs. So a working or trusted program is an excellent oracle. So here the typical use is when the program is being rehosted to a new language or an operating system or an environment or configuration with an intention that the behavior should not change as a result of the rehosting. So is a complete testing possible? Is complete testing possible? My answer is no. So if the objective of the testing were to prove that the program is free of bugs, then testing not only would be practically impossible, but also would be theoretically impossible. So here there are three different approaches that can be used to demonstrate the program's saying that the program is correct. One is functional testing. So here every program that operates on a finite number of inputs and a complete functional test would consist of subjecting the program to all possible input streams. And for each input of the routine, that either accepts the stream and produces the correct outcome or accepts the stream and produces the incorrect outcome or rejects the stream and tells us that it did so. So for example, a 10 character input string has 280 possible input streams and corresponding outcomes. So complete functional testing, which is a sense of impractical. But even theoretically, we cannot execute a purely functional test this way because we don't know the length of the string to which the system is responding. So here, the second type of approach what we are going to use is structural testing. So here, the design should have enough test to ensure that every part through the routine is experienced at least once. Of course, it is impossible because some loops might never terminate. So here, the nature of path through a small routine can be aversome because each loop multiplies the path count by the number of times through that particular loop. So here, a small routine can have millions and billions of paths. So total path testing is impractical. And the third approach is formal proofs of correctness. So here, formal proofs of correctness, they rely on the combination of functional and structural concepts. Here, requirements are stated in a formal language and each program statement which is being examined and is used in steps of an inductive proof so that the routine will produce the correct outcome from all possible input sequences. So here, the impractical things here is that such proofs are very expensive and have been applied only to the numerical routines or to the formal proofs for the crucial softwares such as system security kernels or portions of the compilers. So here each approach that is going to lead to a conclusion that complete testing in the sense of proof is neither theoretically nor practically possible. So coming to theoretical barriers of complete testing, we can never be sure that the specifications are correct and no verification system can verify every correct program, or we can never be certain that the verification system is correct. So not only all the known approaches to the absolute demonstrations of the corrections is impractical, but they are also impossible. Therefore, our objective must shift from the absolute proof to an suitably convincing demonstrations. I hope you understood the concept of model for testing. So that's all for now. If you like this video, please subscribe to my channel and press the bell icon for the latest notifications. Thank you, one and all.